Okay, it's a pleasure and an honor to be here. I mean, this is a center of science education, a center devoted to science education. So, first of all, I should say, I mean, after such a great talk of Palashwal, I'm sort of relieved because, you know, so many of you have come and if after two talks you go back by saying, I didn't get anything, that would have been a very sad thing. So, at least you have got something good in the first talk. So, even if you don't get anything, this thing, I'm under any pressure. So, thank you, Palash. So this is, I feel humbled actually being present here in this place, because this is the center devoted for learning science and science research. The experts here who have devoted their time for learning these techniques of this, devoting research to this, and are very knowledgeable about this. As Rajesh said, so this is my confession to you. So about this. So general structure of the talk is scattered, unfocused. Not because I have not tried to put efforts in this. I have put a lot of effort in. I have given this talk at a couple of places. I have put a lot of effort. The thing is that the issue is so complicated. So I cannot present it in a very focused manner. Sometimes you will see me talking about the school students, sometimes talking to students like you, sometimes to research scholars, sometimes to scientists. Because the whole thing in my mind is interrelated. When I see a scientist behaving certain manner, I see what a child must have been, that person. When I see a child undergoing some education, I see what future scientist that person will turn out to be. So whole thing is interrelated to me. So I can't talk about one like that. I'll have to go back and forth in this. So these are personal experiences. I have personal experiences. We'll exchange those experiences, acquired wisdom, and ask an honest question. What is it all about, learning science and doing research? What is one looking for when a career in basic research is taken? And I will tell you very honestly my experiences, and I expect if you ask me something, there's no pretensions of any kind, from my side at least. So this talk is not a result of any scholarly study on education and research. It is meant to be a discussion mode, sharing with you my own personal experiences, what I have learned from them. What I personally think about good learning and good research, and in no way I'm trying to imply this is the correct way of doing things. There is no correct way of doing things. There are different ways of doing things. This is my way. This is what I find. It depends on a lot of things. It depends on your background. It depends on your priorities. It depends on your values. It depends on a lot of things. How you think about life. These are my views about this thing. But, and I certainly say, many will disagree, probably most will disagree with me, and it's quite fine. I mean, but we all can agree, and this is a wise man told me this, is there is no royal road to research. Ultimately, the only thing that stands by a person is his or her interest in the subject. And that's the point I will focus on. Interest in the subject. And that's the underlying theme of the 3 years here. So discussion will be general, but we'll focus it around physics. That's easier for me to talk. That's my area. So you can replace physics everywhere by the subject of your own interest. So why study physics? The motivation question. So why study physics? Motivation question. So we'll discuss pains and sufferings of conflicting demands of physics education. What should be required of a genuine education leading toward physics research? We should discuss it. It's not the issue whether you can do it or not, whether it's practical in the present education system or not. We always discuss socialism. You know, we always discuss what to aspire for. If the present system may not achieve it, that's a different issue. But we should also always think about what is the right thing eventually which we should aim for. Then eventually we'll get there. If we don't even discuss that, you will never get there. So most important ingredients, apart from technical training, creativity, originality, and imagination, precisely the things almost totally missing in our education at every stage. This I say very firmly, and I stand by that statement. With a little bit of sprinkling here and there, which you see occasionally, you are being part of it here. So here I start with a disclaimer. Following discussion is based on true life experiences. Any similarities with actual educational institutions, educational system, teaching methods, and teachers are totally intentional and real. Credit to the movie Three Idiots for bringing some of these crucial questions to forefront for everybody. Educationists always knew, and they always discuss in education circles, and it remained confined there. This Three Idiot movie brought it out and hopefully forced people to think about some of the issues. In families, in relationship, father, son, father, mother, son, daughters, this relationship that people in the family started discussing. I hope they see movie again and again. Every time it comes, I always watch it. And this is my certification. I certify that all proposals in this talk have been tested on self, and they work to this extent that I have a job that I, what I can do, where I can do what I love, that is research. If you think they will not work for you, you can exchange them for free with other more established ideas, which always work, and to a better extent leading to a real successful career. So, so when I say they always work, this is what you get, okay? And for sure, I should say in any honesty, in an established sense, I will not call myself a real successful scientist. But in the same sense, with equal surety, I'm a very happy scientist. One of the happiest scientists I know. So I'm very happy with my research. I take delight in my research. I am fully content with my research. I take pleasure. So I would like to share how I have lived my life. So, so now I'll start with something very utopian. Introductory remarks, I call it. It's a mere formality because you will say, oh, what nonsense you're talking about. Nonetheless, let me say it. It's a mere formality, but it's important to state the damaging effect which I consider of present examination system on the process of learning. I personally believe examinations are killers of learning. There was Professor T. Trivikram Pati, legendary mathematician from Odisha. I came to know him in Allahabad University. He was head of the Department of Mathematics. I was a BSc student. It was a very odd friendship. The reason he liked talking to me because I was a member of a hostel called Muir Hostel in Allahabad, and which was called IAS Factory. It used to produce, still produces a lot of IAS officers. And I was the only one who wanted to do research. In fact, my hostel mates used to call me Gadha of the hostel. Tum hostel ka naam badnaam karoge, research karne jaate ho, no? And he was very passionate about research. So he said, oh, you like doing research? Oh, we will talk about it. So he, his dream, he was not only a legendary mathematician, an amazing scholar. He would give lectures standing here, 3-hour lecture on infinite series, and there'll be pin drop silence for any audience. He was that capable person. He used to say that I'll build an institution. He passed away before he could build such an institution. I will build an institution where lectures will be held and people would attend what they want to. And at the end, if they really want, I can issue them a certificate that you attended these lectures and that's it. There will be nothing else. That was his dream. he had promised me an advanced position in that institute. Okay. The standard question, if you do away with this utopian thing, I mean, what would students study? Why would students study and how to judge them? This is all very practical questions. It's a very utopian thing I'm saying. Examination system is essential to our learning. We know that thing. And I will just quote, this is a topic of another discussion. I don't want to get into this. Anyway, utopian question presently. The book by Robert Pirsig, The Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance. This is a book on philosophy of life. It's a very beautiful book. The protagonist, in this case, with his son, is traveling across the United States on motorcycle. He likes to maintain his motorbike himself. And through maintaining motorbike, he talks about philosophy of life. So amongst many things he has also discussed about examination system. And he precisely addresses this issue. If there was society in which there were no exam, people will be very confused how people learn, why people would learn. And he addresses it to really good detail. If you want to know it philosophically, what could be there, I would suggest you read it. So as I said, it's a utopian discussion. Discussion is meaningless in the present context. So let us discuss situation in the real world. So we come to question of motivation. So before raising issue of motivation for research students, let us start at the beginning at school. And we say students lack motivation to learn. And we blame it on faulty education system, which is also true. However, I say the statement that a truly motivated student will always find ways to learn. So have we, as teachers, discussed with the student what their motivation was to begin with when they go to college or something or higher studies? Has anybody discussed with them, with the students? If we all know this issue. We all know this issue. So why was it that a movie like Three Idiots was necessary to bring this question to forefront? Standard counseling, if available in places like IITs and other places, education institutions, if available, discusses how to achieve what they want, what you want to achieve. When I joined IIT Kanpur as an MSc student, there was a counseling session for us where they precisely wanted to discuss, you want to do this, you will go for PhD, and that's what they wanted to do. Nobody ever asked me the question, why you have joined? Have you chosen correct thing? Is it what you wanted to do? Nobody ever asked me this question. I'm sure nobody ever would ask you this question now, nobody would ask you question in future. So they will tell you how to get into engineering, how to get into such career. But do we ever discuss with them what why they want what they want. So typical reason is either high marks in the subject, and we know it, neither it means interest nor it means understanding. It means to some level it relates to understanding. You know, I was in BSc Allahabad University, and the subject I hated most was statistics. I had physics, mathematics, statistics. I hated most statistics. So I mugged it up. but I got highest marks in that. Subject I lost, I loved most was physics, and I got least marks in that. So if somebody was guiding me by my marks, they would say, you do statistics. So, there was an institute in Bhubaneswar, Institute of Mathematics and Applications. So they called me for counseling, career counseling of students. So the director got up and he introduced me, and then he asked the students, so how many students want to become, who wants to become engineer, who wants to become scientist, who wants to become doctor? And so many people wanted to become engineer, so many scientists, so many doctors. So very happy, everybody clapped. So when I came up, I said, I'm very impressed, very happy that you guys want, you know what you want to become. And I'm, and these were, say, high school intermediate students. I said, if you say you want to become a doctor, I fully understand. When I was a child, I wanted to become doctor, because doctors help people. As a child, you know doctors help. Now you're saying you want to become scientist and engineer, I'm very confused. Whom have you met ever? Have you ever met a scientist, or have you ever met an engineer? Who motivated you? How did you think you should become scientist and engineer? Or what have you read in literature? What have you read on the internet? Have you read anything which has told you you should become scientist and engineer? So why have you, do you want to become scientist or engineer? What is the reason? So reason is obvious. Either you have got high marks in the subject, so teachers told you you could become that, or the parents have told you this, or some uncle, auntie, or Sharma ji, 3 years ke. Yeah, engineer banega, bacha, engineer banega. So Sharma ji ki wajah se the boy is trying to become engineer. So there's something somebody else is telling you. And so if the motivation was from self-learning, same motivation, it was self-exploration, there's not much to talk, but it's almost never there. So if it was from self-exploration, we don't have to worry about it. We'll not have to worry about it in case somebody was self-motivated, they'll find ways to learn. If there is no teacher here, they'll find some other teacher, they'll go on internet, these days on internet, they'll find it. Now what happens is that interest is a very funny thing, because you know, you may be interested in something, and it may not be consistent with your situations or the options available to you. So there are constraints, often constraints, financial responsibilities, unavailability of choice options. So for example, if you want to, you know, I come from a moderate financial background. So it just turned out that I was interested in science, which was a safe career at that time. Our son, when he was growing up, he was interested in two things, computer science and music. And he shifted to rock music. And he was very passionate. He and his friends formed a band. And he wanted to pursue it. He was in high school at that time, intermediate, and very passionate about it. So we had a very serious discussion, and me and my wife with the child. And we said that, you see, if when we were growing up, and suppose we were interested in music or sports, we could not have pursued those careers. Because our financial background was very moderate. And we had a responsibility of making ourselves independent. So it just happened that we were interested in science and it was a safe career. Music and sports would be dangerous career. In India, they're definitely dangerous. In India, as much as I love India, I think Chetan Bhagat has said that, India is not land for people with dreams. It's not a criticism of India. It is a realization of harsh realities. That if you do not make a career which is safe for you, it can be dangerous. You will not be able to live right. See, if you are in US and you do whatever you want, if nothing, you can go and work in Burger King and you still have a decent life. You'll have a car, you'll have a house, you'll have everything. Not here. You have to have a safe career. So you have to be careful about this thing. So that's what we told our son, that you have to be careful. Now, we didn't have option of pursuing sports or music, but you are in different situation. Me and my wife are both government servants. So we are both faculty members, and we are have a moderate earning, reasonably good earning with the Sex Pay Commission and the Wage Pay Commission. We have a good earning, and we'll leave enough money for you. So we'll have a house also. We'll have leave enough money for you. So you will not have problem of food. You will even have a tiny little car. So you can explore. So you can explore what you want to do in life, not a problem. Of course, he chose to explore computer science along with the, that's his primary thing. That's a different issue. Important thing is, constraints are very important. But with those constraints, there's always options. And people come with more different backgrounds. And I have seen people, in fact, my son's friends, who came from much richer background than us, एंड देयर पेरेंट्स बीइंग मच मोर टेंस देन अस कि व्हाट विल हैपन टू देयर सन, एंड आई वाज टेलिंग देम कि आपको प्रॉब्लम क्या है, इतना पैसा घर में है आपके, अगर आप बच्चा कुछ भी नहीं करेगा उसे प्रॉब्लम नहीं है, कुछ भी नहीं करेगा, वी वांट टू गो फॉर म्यूजिक, व्हाट्स द प्रॉब्लम इन दिस थिंग, इन दिस थिंग, बट नो ही मस्ट बिकम इंजीनियर. सो ही द गाई वेंट टू कोटा, जॉइंड जेईई कोचिंग एंड लेफ्ट आफ्टर वन ईयर, ही कुडंट कोप अप विद द प्रेशर ऑफ दैट. So anyway, so issue is this, that boy wanted to do music first choice, his second choice was physics research. But he was getting trained in JEE coaching. That's the thing. So that's the reality. So important thing is with whatever constraints person has in life with some family, an open and free discussion with student is needed, exploring different possibilities for which student may feel some passion. And why is it important to have work on something which you have interest with? It's obvious, but let me tell it more and more, because that is the thing which, because of which I am standing and confidently saying I am one of the happiest scientists. Because with passion, all the work becomes pleasure. Who knows it better than practicing scientists, at least most of them, I hope. I said some of them, sorry, I am more different than you. Okay. This is the lesson of, when I say three idiots, it's Aamir Khan is not my main person. Aamir Khan was a hero in the movie, you know. Such kind of people are few. Is the Farhan, is the other two guys. When you say two, those are the two guys for me. They are the thing. They are the people. They were not very, very brilliant like the main hero of the movie. So Farhan tells to his father, so what if I earn less money, Abba? I'll be really happy. And this sentence is, I think, incredibly profound, this sentence, and needs to be spoken in families. So if you love something, you'll pay for doing it, even if you choose something that, like, I mean, I miss my chance of learning, say, music, and I learn music now, and I pay for it. When I like something, I pay for it. You know, when you like something, you'll pay for it, and if you like something and you get paid for that, what can be better than that? In society, not everybody gets that privileged situation that you get paid for doing what you like. So if you, from high school onwards, constant discussions with students are needed, of course, exploring their passions, interest constraints, and guiding them to make responsible choices with full awareness. Most parents do not do it. It's a very complex thing. Parents care, obviously they care most about the children. Who cares more than the parents for the children? I'm not undermining their motivation in this thing. Something has gone wrong in their way of thinking. So they think this is the way of the child will be happy. If I make the career of the child, it's not even safe. I mean, it's really a certain way of thinking they have got. In fact, I remember talking to the principal of my son's school and telling him that you should, you do invite these educationists and all that for lectures for your teachers. You need to invite the educationists for the parents of students. Arrange counseling session for the parents. Tell the parents that what they are doing is they are burning out their children. They think they are helping them, they are not helping them. They are hurting them. By 12th class, children don't want to have anything to do with studies. They are burnt out completely. You have killed their chance of remaining in academics completely. So this has to be, teachers have to do it. And in fact, not every teacher also can do it, as everybody knows. Only few people can do it. In wrong hands, it can hurt. Counseling sessions have to be there in every school. Counselors have to be there, and they should discuss. This issue has to be discussed with effectively and with sensitivity. This issue has to be discussed with sensitivity. So I'll continue with motivation question. So if one comes to physics by force, there is not much to talk. Okay. And it's time to rethink. You work for whole life in something someone else chose for you. And that too almost certainly for wrong reason. So physics means anything, engineering or anything, you come for that. Express disagreement in the family. And it does not mean disrespect. You know, we are part of Indian culture. As much as I don't like most aspects of Indian culture, they are extremely feudal and reactionary in my opinion, nonetheless, respect it, I have no problem. So be very respectful to your parents and respectfully disagree. This is not disrespecting them. Respectfully disagree. Respected father, respected mother, I do not agree with you. You know how Farhan pleaded with his father. Nobody can disagree. I loved that still. I mean, the way Farhan pleaded with his father, which father will not agree? Tell me. I mean, but important thing is, if you want to convince your father or mother that I don't want to do what you are telling me, I want to do something different, do you know what you want to do? Are you clear about it? Farhan was very clear what he wanted to do. So unless you are yourself very clear why you want to do what you want to do, you don't have no argument. Your parents will not listen to you, they should not listen to you, I agree. You first find out what you want to do yourself, and then you convince your parents and just follow movies, 3 idiots, and your parents will listen, I can assure you. Plead with them, because they ultimately love you. You know? Parents is nothing more important than their children, I can assure you. I am a parent, so I know that. So I asked a school student who wanted to become electronics engineer, when you think about electronics engineering, do you think about IBM or do you think about a circuit? So if you think about IBM, there's nothing for me to talk. And if you think about a circuit, there's no need to talk. So this is a little bit provocative talk, so don't. I hope you take it in right spirit. if career in physics research is chosen with primary motivation of a good and secure salary, fame, foreign jobs, awards, then you do the following thing. Work extremely hard, submit absolutely all the assignments, don't waste any time, okay, and remain focused and get perfect grades, okay. Which will guarantee good recommendation among, you get good grades, they guarantee good recommendations also. And you know how it works. Right from school, you are introduced to your family friend by your marks. Oh, score 96% aaya hai. Pehla sentence yehi hota hai, 96% aaya. Or your marks are not discussed at all, because 93% ho gaya hoga na, pichli baar 94 aaya tha. 1% kam ho gaya, how will they introduce you to their family friend? They will not. 1% kam ho gaya, okay. In places like IITs, I was in IITs, I tell you, I mean, one wears a hat with Gates marked on it. I really love this book, 5.someone by Chetan Bhagat. I'm not advertising Chetan Bhagat, I like his, some of the books. And this was the first book which struck me literally, because 5.someone, the someone is very important part here. It's not 5.something, 5.someone. The Gates are marked in, okay, I mean, you may find it a little exaggeration. I'm capturing the spirit here. I'm not describing all students, IIT students. I'm capturing the spirit here. The atmosphere is such. There are 5 pointers, 6 pointers, 7 pointers, 8 pointers, 9 pointers, 10 pointers. Generally, 8 points and below form one category. They'll mix with each other. 9 pointers have marginal relationship with 8 pointers. 10 pointers don't talk to anybody. And you don't need to their names. Name ki zarurat nahi hai. Grade is enough. That's a category. So if you have your own idea for a project, and it undoubtedly will be a very simple one. Because when you have done 12th class or BSc level, what do you know? You know some optics, you know Newton's laws, mechanics and things like that. And you better ignore those, okay? Because they are too trivial. If you work on those projects, you can't publish any paper, first of all. Okay, so just ignore it. Why waste time on that? So try to find an advanced research-like project of some senior scientist, and you have good chance of getting it published. Now, this is because the reason I say provocative, these projects are very important for student learning. I am not undermining them at all. In fact, they are very good projects. What they do is that they expose the student to an advanced research topic, and you learn new things, and you be creative in that. And there's nothing wrong in publishing paper. That's not what I'm undermining. What I'm saying is the basic motivation is what? If your motivation actually is in joining project that, oh, actually I would like to learn an advanced topic, and if I work on that, I want to create something nice which might be publishable, I have absolutely no objection. But if that is the motivation that I want to work on this project so that I can publish a paper, there's something wrong here. If that is the main motivation, then something is wrong. That's what I'm saying. So, I have seen this. I feel so sad. I mean, when students, they'll contact for project, and the first thing they will ask is, will there be paper in this? And I mean, some of you present in a morning lecture when I said they'll not give me paper, it's in reaction to those statements. That there's going to be, is there a paper? Because is there a paper? And primary motivation, is there a paper? Or will there be, it has become, now projects have become, projects were supposed to, where they started with the, in fact, I'm very happy to see the way project is conducted here. It's very beautiful. It really caters to the original spirit of project. The idea was to cultivate the innovativity, originality, and creativity of those students. And they do it very well here. But it is spread all across India. The projects are being done now in every college, every engineering, every place the projects are being done. And the students are coming in bulk for the projects. And what they want is, they want a publication, and they want a recommendation letter. And this, to me, this is a problem. This is taking the spirit out of this whole project, which was supposed to cultivate originality and creativity of the students. So of course, I mean, if one wants to do all these things, and you also manage good grade, so congratulations for successful career. So this is a little provocative thing, but I'm just trying to separate out to different ways of doing things. Here, you are trying to, here, not you, I mean, somebody is trying to be successful in the sense of project and all those things, because the aim is a successful career, aim is something successful. Whereas, if the main interest is physics, you have to do all those things anyway. How would you do that thing? If you love physics and that's the primary motivation, because there's nothing wrong with good jobs and nothing wrong with awards, fame and all those things. You should get them if you can. You should get them if they can. If that's the primary motivation, then I have a problem. If they come later after your main interest is physics research, and these things come follow up, it's great. But if that's the main motivation, I cannot identify with that kind of approach. That's all I'm saying. So I'll go through the list again carefully with the attitude of a person whose primary motivation is physics research. So try to work very hard, submit all assignments, get excellent grades, again something. Unfortunately, you will find it difficult. Quite often you may find it difficult. Some people with genuine passion and interest can do it because they're very smart. There are some people who are incredibly smart and they are very passionate and honestly they are interested in this thing and they can do all these things. Yeah, okay. But many cannot, and it's okay. And it's okay. Science research is not a property of super smart people. Everyone with the love of science and some basic abilities has right to do it, can do it. With that, I again will say that super smart in terms of grades does not at all mean original, creative or independent. We evaluate entirely, almost entirely, the capability of a student in some technical training. That is what you evaluate. You don't do well in that, the label is put on your head, you are not good for research. This is not fair. A scientist has to be technically trained first, no question about that, but has to be original, creative or independent. There are a lot of qualities a scientist requires. Einstein made the statement, imagination is more important than knowledge. This statement you must have heard because a lot of times statement would have been thrown at you. Who cares about the statement, imagination is more important. Imagination is rarely tested in examinations, very rarely, and none of these things are tested ever. You know, I attended a seminar in BRC long time ago, more than 15 years ago, and this was about scientific research in the country. And there was a talk by Professor Rohini Godbole on the status of women in scientific research. And one person in the audience got up at the end of the talk and asked this question that, I have read a scientific report that women are not as good in mathematical abilities as men are. And Rohini responded very correctly to show that the social biases of such reports and how inaccurate this kind of science is where such reports are established. I made a comment, I stood up and I made a comment, fully agreeing with Rohini Godbole what answer she answered, but I also would like to add something. I have also that report which you are, read that report which you are quoting. That report had two parts, you only mentioned one part. The second part of the report says that women are found to be much better in using two halves of the brain, which accounts for intuitive thinking. Women are found to be much better at intuition than men. Scientific research requires technical abilities and intuition, both, in fact, amongst other things. Now, where have you put this restriction? This kaha se aa gaya suddenly, ki you are good in one quality and not in other quality. In fact, what we know precisely is that's the problem of great research. Great research, technical ability is one thing. What you require is originality, creativity, intuition, a lot of those things. So this label which is put by one-dimensional evaluation of the person, you are technical great, you are not good, you are labeled like you can't do anything. In fact, it's sort of, we are just talking about scientific research, but this is harder than that. In places which are these advanced institutions like IITs and places like that, our system puts a label on the person overall. It's not just the label is put that you're not good for engineering or science. The student, it's not active, it just happens with the atmosphere. The students feel that they are good for nothing. That is such a ridiculous thing, right? I mean, if you are not good, first of all, as I'm saying, it's not even tested that you are not good for that subject. It's not properly tested. Even if it is so, there are hajar other subjects, there are hajar other things. Why a student is made to feel if they're not good in that thing, they're not good for anything? There's something deeply wrong about that thing. So, with that, so if your thoughts wander in physics about crazy ideas or about other things happening around you, you can't close off yourself to this. I remember in IIT Kanpur, we were students and there was a National Security Act was declared. And we were all very disturbed and we wanted to boycott classes. So we went to students, to student by student, you know, NSA ho gaya hai and what a problem hai, we should really boycott the classes. Most of the students told us, ki, what nonsense, you know, I'm going to finish my MSc, I'm going to go abroad. Okay, why are you bothering me? I'm telling you, this, I really got this response. This, I'm not concerned, this is nothing. So if you are connected to your surroundings, you cannot remain isolated. It's difficult to remain isolated. And I don't mind. I don't think it's a problem. I don't think it's a problem. Of course, what happens is ki your grades will suffer. Don't. When I say no problem, I must warn you. You do any of those things, your grades will suffer and your future will suffer. You pay the cost. You pay the cost, but that you decide whether you want to pay that cost or not. So let them. So if a class is very boring or okay, this is with the humble thing with teachers, don't take it very in a bad way, this is in light sense. If a class is very boring or for late riser, too early in the morning, bunk it, sometimes at least. But remember, you only attend or not, but this is the warning, I mean, you attend or not attend the class for which a teacher has worked very hard to prepare, and that too for you. So how would you feel if people don't turn up for a presentation which you have worked very hard to prepare? So be sincere about assignments and attending classes. But a regimental discipline is not necessary. I do not believe in regimental discipline about attending. Now I have heard that IITs have made 90% classes mandatory. So I was teaching this class in, I got to teach some course, half of the course in IIT Bhubaneswar. So I go my first electrodynamics. First class I'm standing there and 17 students. And in the teaching, suddenly I turned and I saw one boy sleeping, literally sleeping. So I became completely quiet. I said, oh, dhime dhime baat karte hain. So bacha disturb ho jayega. But he overheard and he woke up and he became very embarrassed. हमने कहा नहीं नहीं कोई चिंता की बात नहीं है सो जाओ ओके बल्कि मैं कहता हूँ बाहर जाके सो जाओ यहाँ पे सोने से क्या यहाँ पे सो गए तो तुम सो नहीं पाओगे बाहर जाके सो जाओ इन फैक्ट इफ यू आर फीलिंग सो स्लीपी डोंट हैव टू कम टू क्लास डोंट वरी अबाउट इट दिस नथिंग यू आर गोइंग टू लर्न इफ यू आर स्लीपी डजंट मेक एनी सेंस हैव योर प्रॉपर स्लीप देन यू कम बैक एंड आई नो देयर इज अ 90% कंस्ट्रेंट ऑन योर अटेंडेंस वील डू समथिंग अबाउट दैट डोंट वरी अबाउट इट. So I said, ki, I have no problem if you guys want to come to class, don't want to come to class, don't worry about it. And so next day I go to the class and I'm waiting, there are only four people sitting there. So I waited. I said, ab kab baki log kab aayenge, to 1% sir aur koi nahi aayega. So humne kaha, oh my God, maine to kaha tha, if you don't want to come. I said, koi baat nahi, no problem. I taught four people that day. Next people, many more people. Next class, many. I think they were testing me whether I really mean what I said. And I have always meant it. I mean, I do not understand the attitude of forcing people to attend the class. I mean, these are, of course, not for little children. I'm talking about adult students. If they don't want to attend the class, you are not going to achieve anything by forcing them to sit in the class. That's right. Assignments are absolutely essential for good learning. No question about that. However, at times you really hate working on assignment. Don't work. This is actually a story. I told my son. He used to be given in Avon Loyola School, 10th class, he would be given 40 problems in mathematics to solve every day. We said, Bob, you can't do 40. You need time. You need time. You need time to play. You need to have some watch TV, computer game, khelna hai thoda sona hai. No more than 2 hours of homework after you come from school. Absolutely no more than. Forbidden for this. He said, Baba, aisa karenge to I'll get punished. No. So he said, ki, kitna problem karna hai? Ki, whatever number of problems they gave, divide by suitable number, so the resultant is 4. You solve 4 problems, no more than that, okay? He said, "Vaisa karenge to I'll get punishment." Okay, what is the punishment? They send me out of the class. So actually I asked him, I said, ki bahar kya dhoop padta hai, hawa chalta hai kya? He said, haan, hota hai. I said, isn't that much better than doing a very boring assignment? And interestingly, we had this conversation with the principal of that school. That principal was a great principal. And I told him, we were discussing about, in some different context we were discussing. So I told him, this is what I have told my son. And he was delighted. He was very happy. He said, ki, beta, koi problem nahi, bahar jaya karo. Agar teacher bheta hai, bahar jaya, enjoy, no problem. That teacher didn't last there for long, for obvious reason, that principle. but that's all right, yeah, man, this happened. So this is, after giving you very provocative statements, I must warn you. You cannot undermine hard work which is needed to prepare foundations. You cannot. No activity can be fun all the time. You have to give it due share of sweat, otherwise you cannot do it at all. And you know, I mean, even highly talented people achieve what they did with tremendous hard work. You see, I've seen recently, I saw this Sachin, The Billion Dreams. I've seen Dhoni and many other such pictures. I mean, they were talented people, but they worked incredibly hard for what they achieved. So, you know, musicians, if you say, no, I love music and I want to do music, what subject, topic of your interest, you will have to practice for days, hours, hours, month after month, year after year, before you yourself can start enjoying it. Otherwise, it's painful to your own ears, you know. Your music is painful to your own ears if you don't practice, and you have to go through that before you start enjoying it. Those parts are understood. That part is understood. So next time you think the class is boring, remind yourself, the class is not for entertainment, it's for learning. You know, I tell my students always that you should not miss out things. Don't miss out seminar, don't miss out colloquium. That person is presenting something, you'll always benefit something. You'll always get something from that thing. The teacher, if the teacher is telling something, it's for that person is throwing things at you, you know. And it is for your benefit. Whatever you can absorb is good for you. What I'm guarding you against is mechanical approach to learning and thinking. That's what I'm guarding you against. Do not learn, solve, think, choose anything. Don't do mechanically. That's what I'm most afraid about in our education system. Things have become incredibly mechanical, incredibly mechanical. The culminating in the JEE coaching center, which are the hallmark of this machine industry. Of course, when I say mechanically, solving large number of problems to learn a technique well is not mechanical, because you know what you are doing. You are training yourself for preparing. That's not mechanical. Has to be understood mentally mechanical. Mentally mechanical. That's what I'm saying. So doing well in courses reflects your understanding often, but good grades are not good enough to cost the soul of a student, I believe. There is no shame in admitting that you are human and have weaknesses like a desire to have full sleep. Of course, leaving special days, you know, before exam or some other days. This is not. Where do 97% marks matter in the end? Where do they matter? I had this discussion with my son. He was under, so we kept counseling him constantly. I always told him, don't worry about the marks, understand the subject. Understand the subject. Understanding is what will remain with you. I told him 96, 97, they don't matter in the end. Nobody cares in the end. You should get the basic percentage so that you can appear in competitive exams. Otherwise, don't worry about it. Very tense. He comes to me after some middle in 10th class. He says, you told me the grades don't matter. My friends have told me that if I do not get above this some 94, 95%, I won't get admission in science anywhere in Bhubaneswar. I said, that can't be true. Okay, so I found out some of the schools, yeah, it was true. 94 ke niche nahi milta admission wahan pe. I said, Dota, just wait a minute, let me find out. So I contacted my friend in Allahabad. There was a professor in Allahabad. I contacted him. I said, find out from Allahabad, is there a decent school which can give marks in low percentage in scientific stream? He said, he find out, 60% ho jayega. So I told Puhup, I said, ki 60% wahan ho jata hai. Agar yahan nahi hua, to we'll shift to Allahabad, don't worry about it. We'll shift to Allahabad. You'll do what you want to do, but we'll find a place. There's no difference in different schools too much, frankly speaking. In fact, some of the high-priced schools where people compete to put their children are the worst enemies of children, because they are made like performers there. They are made like performers. These teachers are making their students performers, and they're killing their any original instinct or anything childish inside them. What I feel most pained actually is our children are losing their childhood, which is irreparable. वो गाना जो है ना वो ये वो बारिश का पानी ना वो बच्चे बड़े होकर नहीं गाएंगे वो गाना. आई कैन अश्योर यू ऑफ दैट, बिकॉज दे हैवंट हैड दैट चाइल्डहुड. ना उनका बारिश का पानी था, ना उनकी कागज़ की बोट थी, कुछ नहीं था उनका. कागज कश्ती भी नहीं थी, उनका बारिश का पानी भी नहीं था. एंड दिस इज द लॉस विच इज इररिपेरेबल फॉर अवर सोसाइटी, आई थिंक. सो डज द लाइफ एंड इफ यू डू नॉट अचीव हाई ग्रेड्स? स्टूडेंट्स फील दैट वे. You know, I in my IIT Kanpur, we were a batch of 8 students in 2-year MSc. I did BSc and then appeared in 2-year MSc there. It was not a very tough competition. It was easier than JEE. I don't think I could have made through JEE. It was too tough for me, I think. But I did BSc. I didn't even know at that time there is something like JEE. I went to MSc 2 years. We were 8 students. And we were very different from the integrated students who were JEE students. We were misfit. We were BSc, we are university background people, no? So we were very misfit. They were high profile people, okay. But among the 8 of us, we were very close ties with each other. You can meet, most of my friends have remained in science and physics, and you can talk to them, and they will tell you one thing. I was not one of the high graders in my batch at all. Somewhere in middle something. I was not a very high grader in the IIT. I couldn't cope, many of us couldn't cope up with the assignment system. But they will all tell you, I was the only one who had absolutely no tension of examination. Absolutely no tension. The people who performed much better than me had much more tension than me. People who performed less than me had more. I had no tension. And they often asked me, and I told them, I tell the tricks to anybody who feels tense about examination, but it doesn't work for most of them. What can I do? So what was my trick? My trick was simply this, before my examination, I would sit and think, so what happens if I fail all this examination? What happens? And then I'll realize it's not such a terrible thing. I know life will become very hard, but just I can still do things, I can do some, open some restaurant, I can maybe do some tuition to students or things like that, music, some of the things, life is not going to end. There are a lot of things I can do. This is a serious discussion. A serious discussion with yourself. An honest discussion with yourself. It's not an easy thing to say. When you say, I have no problem becoming a cook, do you respect a job of a cook equally as you respect a scientist? That's the issue. If you don't, then this solution will not work for you. It's not going to work for you. When we see people cooking in home, women cooking in home mostly, do we respect their activity equally as we expect their husbands who are professors or engineers? If you do not, then this is not going to work for you. If we do believe that all human activities are respectable equally, then what is to worry about? There's so many things to do in life. You try your best in one thing, it doesn't work, there are a hundred things, other things to do. So I have never been tense. Okay. So don't lose perspective. There's much to life. That's what it is. Save your ability to think freely, joyfully, with perspective and with taste. And this I consider the most important part of the character of a skilled scientist. I keep putting this skill because technical abilities I should not undermine. I'm not undermining technical abilities. They are the most important part of scientists. That has been in background. You are all getting trained in that. I'm very happy for this thing. Do not forget the remaining things, that's what I'm telling you. And remember, this is not a race. It is made to feel like a race. From your childhood, you are made to run. First aana hai. Arre bhai, kyun first aana hai? Agar first aana hai, iska matlab hai ki kisi ko second, third, fourth aana hai. Right? I just achha number lana hai, na? I have to get a good marks, that's all. I have to learn subject well. First aane ka matlab kya hota hai? Agar first nahi aaye, to kuch problem ho jayega kya? First, not division, first position. So we are all, division to theek hai. Division is good, but position is the problem. Top karna hai. Toppers are regarded, second position holders are not regarded. This is the thing. You must beat others. No, it's not a race. I consider this the most important quotation from Albert Einstein. And I request the students constantly work on that. It is essential that the student acquire an understanding of and a lively feeling for values. He must acquire a vivid sense of the beautiful and of the morally good. Otherwise, he, with his specialized knowledge, more closely resembles a well-trained dog than a harmoniously developed person. So let's continue. 45 minutes. Huh? So continue. If you love physics, they are continuing with that theme. So if you have any idea for a project, which again undoubtedly will be a very simple one because you have early background, work on those with high priority. Okay? But you must take advice and help of senior scientists in evaluating those projects and developing them further. Be sure that motivation is, okay, you see often, motivation for your project is not to disprove Einstein. This is very tempting at a young age. I want to become the greatest scientist. Greatest scientist to disprove greatest scientist. Einstein disprove kar do, sab ho jayega. Something is fundamentally flawed there, right? If you are trying to develop an idea because you are learning a subject and the idea comes, that's idea you want to pursue. So just be careful about that. So this is my statement about working on an advanced research like project with some senior scientists gives you a technical ability, an early exposure to research topic, and some scope of creativity. All these are very positive aspects, and they're very useful from that sense. But those projects do not give outlet to your full creativity. They do not. Because this is sort of a homework problem which has been given to you. This is creativity of the scientist. Scientists who have generated this problem. The scientist is creative, is given a problem to you. So the problem will train you, will give you early exposure of research, and will also give you outlet to your creativity, which homework problems also do. So in that sense, but along with those, in fact, you take it this way in a constructive way, work on those problems because they are your method of learning how to generate new ideas. So take help of scientists, to give you projects, work on those projects, and along with that, try to develop ideas of your own. This habit of generating your own ideas is important if you want to become a scientist. If you have not developed it earlier, and you keep waiting later, it will become difficult. And it happens. It's not switch that you will switch on. Ab PhD on khatam ho gaya, switch on kar denge, idea aana shuru ho jayega. Aisa to nahi hota. No. If you have not been thinking originally, there's a problem in that. If you have been generating your own ideas, it will come much more naturally to you. So whatever will come, see, the important thing is it will come with trivial problems because that's your background. But that's all right. Always the subject on which you have command, that's where you can be most creative. And that's where you start with. Then you will leap on and you learn more topics and you'll be creative even the new things you are learning. So do not get into the habit of looking to someone else to give you research problem or open a direction for you. It's okay to start with like that. And once in a while, it's always okay. Because if you don't have an idea, you'd ask some scientist to give you a project. Great, absolutely no. But if this becomes a habit, this is how you always do things, there's a problem. So you do that, and along with that, you try to cultivate your own way of thinking in new direction. So choosing research area. So research problems. So set priorities. Job security is very important. So careful of risky areas. So this is somebody asked me, sorry. So how do you choose what problems you choose? So that's the kind of approach I'm trying to address here. So look inside you for the selection. What excites you? What appears interesting and important? What appears interesting and important? Be aware of the other works. You cannot, don't come up with, I think, something and ignore it. Nowadays, internet's very easy. Be aware of other works, but do not start morning search of archive for papers of other big people, looking for what can be changed in those works to write a new paper. It will certainly get citation. I am telling you, this approach is killing science. And it is so rampant in scientific community, I cannot tell you this thing. I know community, set of people who will tell you honestly, this is what they do. They'll start the archive search, उसका पेपर देखना है, इसका पेपर देखना है, और उसमें आप क्या चेंज कर सकते हैं, उसमें क्या चेंज करते हैं. इट्स ओके इफ यू कैन नॉट डू नथिंग एल्स, बट हैव यू ट्राइड एनीथिंग एल्स. इफ यू आर डूइंग दिस बिकॉज दिस पेपर्स विल गिव यू बिगर साइटेशन देन योर ओन आइडियाज, यू थिंक अगेन वाई यू केम टू साइंटिफिक रिसर्च. इफ यू केम टू साइंटिफिक रिसर्च, दिस इज ऑल फॉर दोज पीपल हु केम टू रिसर्च फॉर लव ऑफ फिजिक्स. नो, इफ यू केम बिकॉज लव ऑफ फिजिक्स, then what have you lost, what have you forgotten in this all way that you started doing this thing? So ask this question: does this problem address an important or interesting issue? And this is very delicate. You can't be too ambitious. I'll solve this fundamental problem, you know, that. So this is where you need advice of senior people and all that. But also do not fool yourself with dishonest justification of a superficial analysis. You don't want to be a scientist who is incredibly proud of their work, which nobody considers of any good. And sometimes it may happen for good works also, somebody. But quite often it is because work is not good, actually. Quite often it happens. Work is not good. You are just feeling incredibly proud because it's your personal work. What is happening? You are fooling yourself. Just fooling yourself. Honesty to yourself, I have major disagreements with Mahatma Gandhi. Major disagreement, but one thing I truly admire of Mahatma Gandhi is truthfulness to yourself. Truthfulness, which that he lived for, he lived that way as much as possible amongst many we know. Lage Raho Munna Bhai, aap log picture dekha hai? Lage Raho Munna Bhai, okay. So that sort of illustrates it. So I think truthfulness to yourself answers everything here. So once you are true to yourself, and once you are true to yourself, it also gives you a courage which is unmatched. So, so don't say these sentences even as jokes. I hear these sentences, I must say I'm pained. Okay. I want to write a physical evaluator. I want to write in Nature. I want to write in Nature. That's the statement. I want to write a science paper. That's the motivation. Paper problem dimag mein nahi hai abhi. Ye nahi idea ki subject mein kaam karenge. Kya research problem mein kaam nahi. I want to write a science paper. What is it? Why have you come to scientific research if that's your main motivation for this thing? I believe such statements act as slow poison. They affect your basic attitude towards research and your sense of recognition. Sense of recognition. You are not able to recognize what is a good research problem on which you should work. Your recognition is coming from PRL. These journals are extremely good journals and very difficult to publish paper. So do not think I am undermining these journals. If you get paper published in those journals, it's certainly very good paper because it's not possible to publish otherwise. They are highly competitively referred papers, the reviewed journals. So if you get, I'm talking about the motivation of this thing. So you choose a great problem and work, and then try to publish in this. See, what I'm telling you is this. So suppose you get a very good problem, you solve it beautifully, and only journal which is going to publish is a very trivial journal. But a very popular journal, famous journal, has agreed to publish it with, when you cut down all the interesting things in this. What would you do? That is the test of your character. That is the test of your character. So everybody becomes PhD, okay? So what is called PhD? Doctor of Philosophy. Now, can people say anything about philosophy? When did they learn anything about philosophy? Science used to be called natural philosophy. Connection to nature is disappearing in several branches, and philosophy is completely lost. Nobody discussed philosophy. So can you say when your analysis is scientific, when not? And do you participate in discussions like this is not really science? So when people discuss like that, are these discussions silly discussions? This is science, this is not science. Anyway, I mean, this always was an important issue. It has become incredibly important issue in the last 3 years, I can tell you. Incredibly important. What is science? What is not science? You better learn what is science, what is not science. Otherwise, you are going to all believe that the Ganesha's cut hand is going to be tell us that we had a plastic surgery in our early. That's what good. So you better learn what is science, what is science, what is not science. With only some vague notion of scientific method like predictive power or falsifiability, some sentences you have read, you do not become much different from a pundit in a temple. A degree and a scientific research paper, they do not make you into scientist. You are a scientist if you think scientifically, act scientifically, analyze scientifically. You should be a scientist in all these things. It's not about, not research paper, not degree which makes scientist. So you should learn philosophy at least to some level. So back to learning, get control of your education. So don't blame teachers and classes. You can blame them, but where will it matter? You can say, I didn't have good teacher, I didn't have classes, so hence I am a poor student, hence I suffered. Who is going to suffer? You are going to suffer. Your education is going to suffer. What's the point of blaming? Okay. Get control of your own studies and think in a positive way. And this is my way of thinking in a positive way. I say bad teachers are good. So why are they good? They give you choice. You don't want to learn, then you don't. They make you independent. If you don't learn yourself, then you don't learn. Independence, I think, is the most important criteria of quality of a system. They teach you wrong things sometimes, okay? And that's, I think, even better. You know, it's like going to a city, and knowledge is like learning about roads. You go to a different city, and you want to ask somebody, where is that building? And they tell you, that's that building. And you go, and you reach, that's it. If they tell you in wrong direction, you will wander here, there, and you'll learn the whole city. And that's what is going to happen. So basically, I'm trying to put you that take advantage of every situation in a positive manner and get control of your studies. So if they don't motivate, then that's no excuse at all. If they don't motivate, you start asking your own questions, why you are in this field at all, if you need them to motivate. Painful to see fashionable statements displayed in bold in schools, playful learning methods, creativity nurtured, it's all blatant lies. Teachers don't mean it, and parents don't want it. There are very few schools, mainly in big cities, and I mean, I think Bombay has some, Bangalore has, Delhi has some, and it's very good for them. In fact, I envied my friends who were in these big cities when we were, our child was growing up, but it was very difficult. So where alternative education system is provided for students. So even institutions of advanced learning, IITs, ICERs, NICER, and other such institutions, statements are given, creativity and originality will be encouraged. Where is it? I had a story to tell about NICER because I was part of the NICER's blueprint was made in our faculty meeting in IOP, and statements was there that NICER will be, that statement was written, that NICER will be an institution where creativity and originality will be nurtured. So I asked, that the director was Professor Vyogi at that time, in faculty meeting I asked Professor Vyogi, I was touched by the statement that originality and creativity will be nurtured. I'm just confused because I didn't see anything following that. How will it be done? He said, that's a challenge. That still remains a challenge, by the way. So a good scientist is imaginative, creative, original, and of course technically competent. We take care only of the last part, but often at the cost of other parts. And efforts made, if at all, for encouraging other qualities are almost a total failure. So imagination and thought experiment, you know, university education generally more emphasis on descriptive learning, less on problem solving, but the room for concept is self-study. So I learned really good deal of physics in my BSc because there was nothing to do for whole year. For 11 months, you didn't have to study, nothing. You do what you want to do, and 1 month you prepare for exams and you pass the exam. That's what you do. It's a terrible way of learning a subject, terrible way. You don't learn anything what they're teaching, basically, that thing. But of course, you don't waste totally. Some people waste, some of us didn't waste. We learned something else. And we were trying to explore our creativity, originality, we did. So let's put it this way, when we were not learning any subject, at least we made use of this in terms of imagination and thought. But that's not really good way of saying that system is any good. IITs, ICERs, and ICER are very well planned, very well disciplined, and they do fantastic job of teaching. But they are so much tight with time, so much tight with time. 8:30 morning to 5:30 in the evening, and there's no time. I remember I had a major disagreement with Professor H.S. Mani, serious professor at IIT Kanpur. So I always used to tell him, we have serious problem with the too much time. I don't have any time to think about anything. All institutes are not like that. I'll give you, there's a Chennai Mathematical Institute. And now same H.S. Mani actually teaches there, and I just reminded him this time. Chennai Mathematical Institute, the people who are doing undergraduate courses, they have two classes in a whole day. Two classes, that's it. These are good students, two classes, they're loaded classes, but that's all they have, two classes. Of course, remaining time, they study very, very hard. Very, very hard, they study. The two classes, very loaded classes. So all I'm trying to say is that this is not a unique way of doing 8:30 to 5:30. There may be other ways of doing things like that. But anyway, the bottom line is that there is no time left for any IIT or these people to have do anything. Let me just skip this part. I'll skip this part because I'm cutting short with time. So I want to come back to this. This also I'll skip. I have only 2-3 minutes, right? No.
No, as far as arrivals, you can take 10 minutes.
Oh, okay, fine, okay. So let me talk about this. This is my favorite thing. It may not relate to you, but you may meet students and you will appreciate this. Vernacular to English changeover. This issue may not be relevant to some institution, but very relevant to most students in India. Most important requirement for scientific learning is a free flow of imagination and completely free discussions. Okay. Especially when learning qualitatively new ideas and concepts. And most students study in vernacular up to plus 2 level, most students. For them, higher study brings an abrupt change to English. And thinking in an alien language becomes hard, free discussion becomes impossible. And all that is when you are learning new subjects like special relativity and quantum mechanics. By the time students become comfortable in English, they have gone through these subjects. So many important questions and discussions have been lost. So my own experience, I studied up to class 12 in Hindi, total Hindi. Technical words were in Hindi. Wavelength was tarang there for me. Sine was ja, cosine was koja. And I go to BSc, Allahabad University, everything is in English. I was totally lost. And I couldn't ask any question. I would sit and there was a class going on in mechanics, I remember. I was bubbling up with questions, but I couldn't frame sentences in English, so I couldn't ask anything. So eventually he started teaching special relativity, but my most passionate topic. I was really into it, okay. And then I also noticed that there are people who are asking very good questions in very good English. And I have questions which are at least equally good or maybe more useful questions. So I got courage. And first question I asked, I always remember my first question I ever asked a teacher in Hindi. I said, ki, sir, ye time dilatation kya vastav mein hota hai? I was incredibly puzzled with time dilatation. And I couldn't believe this actually happens. The twin paradox, I said, cannot be true. You know, that it cannot happen. It must be some coordinate artifact. So this teacher who was a gold medalist of Delhi University, a very good teacher actually, he came to me, what do you mean by vastav mein? So I didn't know what to say. So main to kehna tha, keh diya tha. So there was a student friend sitting close to me. He said, sir, what he means is, does it really happen? Then a discussion ensued and I kept talking Hindi, kept talking English. I took it, my barrier was broken because of my tremendous desire to ask in relativity, and I had thought a lot about relativity. Otherwise, I would not have been able to ask. That was long ago. I went to Allahabad University for giving a colloquium. And the first time I gave a colloquium, and I told my friends there I would like to give in Hindi. They said, no, 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 give in English. It's UP. If you don't talk English, nobody respects you. Right? So that's the problem. So I okay, fine, I gave in English. But at the end of my talk, I told students, you ask questions in whatever language you want, English or Hindi. Not a single question was asked in English. Not a single question. students, they come from Hindi background dominantly. And because of them, even the students who were convent educated, even they felt embarrassed, even they asked questions in English, in Hindi. So questions were all Hindi. So next time I went, I prepared a colloquium entirely in Hindi, in Devanagari. In fact, this is on the website, aapke website pe hai. It's written in Devanagari script, totally in Hindi. I talked in Hindi, and this I cannot tell you the reception I received from that. So I just some of the things. So students will ask questions. Sir, aapki baaton se mujhe aisa aabhas hota hai. No, this sentence is very telling. This is telling intimacy of the thought of a student. And this he could not have expressed in English because this boy was from Hindi background. He could not have expressed. This is what is needed. For a scientific discussion, this kind of intimacy with the language is needed. So my feeling is ki, my PhD students, Odia students, very quiet in discussion. They wouldn't speak anything. So I used to always say, tum log bahut shy ho, vagera, vagera. So once there was an invitation to me from Doordarshan about a discussion session with an astrologer. So I said, aapko to Odia ka chahiye, I don't speak Odia, take my students. So they took the students. I watched that program on TV. There was a Jyotishacharya and there was an anchor. Beginning, Jyotishacharya was very aggressive. One was a boy, one was a girl, my students. Towards the end, he was talking madam, towards the end of the thing. Because they really tore him apart in Odia. I had never seen them that bold in scientific discussion. I was astonished myself, my own students after several years. I had never known that they can discuss like that. Because they were speaking Odia, they were absolutely remarkable in those discussions. That's what happens when you speak your mother tongue. So what is needed actually is a buffer. When students come after 12, what's needed is a buffer. I think teachers have to be sensitive towards that. Do not take this as a license to start speaking in that language, say Maharashtrian, Bengali, Tamil. That you start speaking that language and isolate everybody else. Do not do that. Be sensitive to other people also present. But talk in mixed language. I mean, you think technical words are now mostly taught in English, that's all right. But they have to mix language. People should be able to express in whatever language they can express. And this, there should be some buffer period of that kind if you want a proper learning. Now, alienation physics experiment is something I feel very passionate about. So, this is broken right from the beginning. The experiments are taught as black boxes. This is laboratory and that's what you do there, that's the thing. You know, experiments start from your home itself. Then everything around you is experiment. What you need is a playful approach towards tools and components. I hope you have heard this story. Einstein is 5 years old, trembled and grew cold when he saw a magnetic compass. His uncle had given it, magnetic compass. He trembled and grew cold. Do we give our children magnetic compass as gift at all these days? Do they even have time to play with them and grow cold and tremble and grow cold? No, they are busy in homework. They don't have time to play with any of these things. They will, even the beautiful experiments of optics they do in lab, in such a mechanical way, they completely deprive them of any pleasure. And most often it's not done. In my son's school, there was no experiments done at all. And he's clearing this exam. I said, you can't do this. So we brought a drawing board. We bought an optics board. We bought optics control. You can do it at home. It's beautiful. You will enjoy it, the experiment. You don't have to. Science projects were designed for students for this purpose. Science projects at school level were designed so students can explore their creativity. They don't. Most science projects don't originate from students. When we, as judges, when we evaluate the projects, I have stopped being judges. I don't participate in judging anymore because I get into trouble. Because students of high school intermediate level, they are building circuits which they don't understand. they have no idea. So, and much worse than that, science modeling competitions have turned into quiz competition, craft competition with access to good electronic shops, specializing science model building and heavy download. Students present someone else's work and claim they have made it. This is the worst damage you can do. You are teaching a student dishonesty right from childhood. When judges will ask, oh, beta, tumne banaya? Haan, sir, maine banaya. And they have bought it. They have bought it. If they have not made it, their uncle has made it. Or their brother, somebody else has made it. Okay, then say somebody else has made it. Okay, no. They are claiming somebody else's work as their own. You are teaching, you are compromising integrity of a scientist right from early childhood. He will see nothing wrong later on. In attempts to provoke students to be ambitious and advance in thinking, the link to foundation is broken. They don't think a simple project is good enough. A simple project, high school, intermediate, what they should be building? Lenses, magnets, wires, that's what they should be building? No, it has to be nanotechnology. unless they build nanotechnology, something about something, they won't. They will build circuits, with they have no clue about those circuits, nothing about that, but they will build those circuits. Science research is not a job. This is my firm belief. It is a way of life. It will reflect in every aspect in your life. Otherwise, one is compartmentalized, part this and part that. So do you discuss science with others? Do you discuss science with others? Others doesn't mean go to villages only and talk. With your parents, with your siblings, with the people who work in your home. Do you tell them? Do you tell them about exciting things? So get involved in science education at popular level, and you'll be surprised how much you learn from that. It's very easy to explain a technical concept to another trained person. It's incredibly hard to explain a technical concept to a person who is not trained in science, because you have to massage that topic, subject, that concept, modulate it, and tune it to the language of the person who that person understands. Every time you make that attempt, you understand it a little deeper. So start doing that, not for just, of course, it's your benefit, but also it's a matter of social responsibility. The knowledge which you have acquired in society, you have an obligation to share it with others. I'll stop in just 2 minutes, sorry. Yes. Oh, okay, by the way, I mean, I said that you play with lenses, magnets. I hope everybody watches science fiction movies. I advertise science fiction movies every time. You enjoy, start enjoying science fiction movies. Okay, I think maybe I can just stop here. Let me just skip these things. So I'll stop this final lesson. So this is summary of what I have told. Look inside you if you love physics. Get control of your own learning and training. And for learning stages, from learning stages to research level, never forget why you came for this. Never forget why you came for this. Because you love it. And I had another story, but I will not tell this thing. Okay. So, so balance learning pressure. Homework, exam, very important thing to do, but you should have some fun moments also. I never believed in this key, you know, suffering now for later pleasure. It had never convinced me. I would always combine the two. Okay. And so choose a research problem which you like, not with somebody else great scientists like. There is a difference between getting motivated by great scientists' work and simply following them. Okay. And as I said, key professional counseling is very important. So I'll stop with this. Robert Frost, two roads diverge in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by. That has made all the difference. And I dare you to carve a new path for yourself. Thank you.
So, should we have some?
I don't mind. I don't know if
there were suggestions, comments, questions. I think there are several issues. I've been working on some of these issues for several years. And still not clear about what should be answered. So, comments, feedbacks, questions, suggestions, anything is welcome.
Your own experience. Sir, actually, one of my professors has had a very interesting story. So what he did was that he said that he was quite interested in physics right from his school level, and then he got into university and all that. But he said that as he actually got into research, he found out that the research was actually controlled by the funding agencies. So he wasn't allowed to work on the problems that really interested him, and was forced to work on those that were actually like required by the society to be solved as soon as possible. So he said that after that, he just left doing research at all. So what do you think of this?
It can happen. I am aware of certain institutions where this can happen. There are a lot of pressures of similar kind. You fight as much as you can. As I said, you at every step you remind yourself why you came to this area, because you love it. But love can sustain you as much, you know. If the other pressures are serious pressures, and sometimes they can happen. If they are becoming too overpowering, you have to decide, take some hard decision and change. You are never one-dimensional. If physics is, even if you love physics more, there is always something which you love a little bit less than that. Shift to that. There is always going to be some pressure of this kind in the institutions.
With every love, you have to make some compromises. So even in this love, maybe some compromises.
But often you have to, often the compromises are not so serious that you have to quit it. Depend on, you see, yes. I'll just tell you one thing. I mean, when I was a young faculty, so I'm not trying to tell you that this, every every institution, every place had certain politics and things like that. So when I was a young faculty, we came up for promotion. Me and my wife were exactly at the same level. We came up for promotion. And I had taken up some fights with some people. So my promotion was getting delayed. Eventually, we got promotion same date, but was seriously delayed. She got promotion, my was seriously delayed. So some of my well-wishers told me, your promotion is getting seriously delayed. It's not fair. You go and talk to these authorities. I said, you know, what does this person think? You know, I came to physics because I love physics. I would do physics if I have to pay for it. I would do physics if they put me in jail for this thing. So does he think I'm doing physics for promotion? I don't care. But saying this, I fully appreciate what he has said. There are certain funding agencies will block you from doing research what you want to do. Then what do you do? Then what do you do? Don't have a choice.
Sir, everyone does not know, means everyone has no clear cut about what they want
put
to do.
Put mic to you.
Yes, sir. So everyone is not clear cut about what they want to do. Many are confused.
Agreed.
So they need a force to guide them in some way at least.
I completely agree.
So how would you suggest that?
Beautiful. Exactly that is the question. That is why precisely I say you need counselors. We need counselors who will discuss with you. The way it is decided right now is by our completely arbitrary decisions. High marks or Sharmaji and things like that. No, that's how it's decided. That's a completely wrong way of doing it. You need counselors. Counselors are not there in the schools. Counselors are not there in the schools. My advice will be such people, get hold of some scientist, or if it's science, or if it is, suppose you want to go to music, get hold of some people. By the way, you guys are in better position than we were. Internet is available. Expose yourself. Go to the whatever you wanted to, whatever areas come to your mind. See, something you will have to come up. So come up with dozen ideas. Go to all those internet searches, talk to people in those areas, search as much as you can, and then contact people in those areas. Educate yourself. It's your life. Don't forget, you are going to live entire life in that area. It is your moral responsibility and full responsibility to educate yourself, expose yourself, and do something about it.
So yes, but everyone does not have resources, right?
Internet, everybody has.
Yes,
I don't
agree.
Cyber cafe, 20 rupees 1 hour. Everybody has access. I don't believe that everybody doesn't have. Of course, even in remote villages, I'm telling you, I'm part of some education program in Bhubaneswar. We got people completely from rural areas, and I told them precisely this. Educate yourself, and you don't have internet in your village, but you go to neighboring places where you have internet. Take 20 rupees it costs you. And just 20 rupees, spend 1 hour there and educate yourself, and here's my mobile number. Call me from that place and tell me, call me that thing or send me an email and I'll respond to you in detail. Whomever you come in contact, you ask them, people are happy to help. They are teachers. We are all teachers. We want you guys to contact us. We want to help you. So contact teachers and they will help you. They will guide you.
I just wanted to make a comment on this person's question. Life is not just a straight and narrow career path. There are many people who, people also evolve and new interests develop. You can
absolutely
always make a change. Many
absolutely
people
I completely
have
agree. Done completely, yeah. I completely agree. I mean, I in response to you, I said, it's never a one-dimensional interest. You, if you are most interested at some topic, that is only at that time T, by the way. Even that interest will change, and even at that time, you have several other interests. And it can, the trajectory is like that, and be flexible about that. India doesn't allow too much flexibility, that part is true. Other places you have more flexibility, but there's still some flexibility. We don't utilize that full flexibility even in India.
Questions, comments?
Yeah.
Just another question related to this interest thing. I mean, how do I know when I'm really interested in something? Is there some way of figuring out? Because as a young person, I might be interested in this and in this and this.
Yes.
So is there something that you would like, you know?
Yeah,
it's
a very difficult question. I don't know how to answer this question in a concrete way. What I will say is interest keeps changing. As I told you, when I was a child, I wanted to become a doctor. So it kept changing. So, and it kept changing. I went along. It's called co-moving flow, right? So my interest kept changing. And as time went along, I kept changing my interest. And at any point, I do think I had reasonably clear idea, at least for myself, that this subject interests me more than other things. At least for me, this happened. I think it happens with many people. What he was asking the question, if it doesn't happen for you, then what do you do? And I think if it doesn't happen, suppose you get confused. So I find this interesting, that interesting, all of them interesting, or none of them equal any interesting at all. You need people to talk to. You need people. So actually, yeah, maybe this question elaborates more. Suppose I said, ki, you can explore internet, but you will explore internet only if you know that these are subjects. Suppose you're totally confused. You have no idea. You talk to some people. Somebody has to ask you questions to remind you. and cultivate your interest in something. Okay, let's see whether which subject you find challenging, which subject you find interesting. If you don't find anything interesting amongst the subject you have found, you have not exposed yourself enough, I would believe. Expose yourself more, you will probably find. It's probably, you know, it's like that you khana aapko sab tarah ka diya jata hai. You find every dish equally tasty. Very, very unlikely. I haven't found anybody who finds every dish absolutely of equal taste. So find your taste. You'll find something more tasty than other. Eat more variety of food, that's what I'm saying. You'll find more, something tasty.
Just want to add something interesting that happened to me. I recently visited a place, I don't know how many of you know, there's a place in Udaipur called Swaraj University. I don't know how many of you know about this place. This place is an kind of a space for people, young people from 18 to 25. It's a university, but it's not a university. It's a place for you to discover your own interest, your own likings. So it's a two-year program wherein you can do trekking, you can do whatever you want. You want to do music, dance, drama, theater, anything you can do. You can do science also. They are very good students doing biology, microbiology, and physics there. It's an open program. So there are places now coming up, even in India. They, of course, don't give a degree unless and you ask for it. It's not a valid degree anywhere. It's just for your own discovery of your own self and your interest. So there are places coming up
in
India also. Of course, you have to do your basic education and then enter that place where you can discover your own liking. Or you can do it before and then do a formal degree. So you can, after your 12th, you can go to this place, discover yourself for 2 years, see what, explore various things, do something for 1 month, 2 months, that, with of course help of mentors. So they have collaborations with several good institutions in India, including IITs, where students are mentored for short duration in various topics, various subjects, and then they come back and share their ideas with this place. It's a very traditional old place. Developed, it's called Tapovan Ashram, you read about it. It's a very interesting place. But this is actually coming up in India now. So I think people are realizing importance of these places, this kind of places. Yeah. And probably eventually, after you finish your master's probably or bachelor's, you will get some place where you can actually do this exploration and discovering your own interest and things.
Actually, like I would say that while you are doing this thing, since students are not in habit at all of determining their own interest, start doing local optimization, I call it. This global optimization of all activities is of course very ideal thing, but at least start with local optimization, what fields you know, what thing you have been exposed to, at least determine from that whether you have any interest. If you find confusing answer, then look for bigger options like this. Whatever fields you have in this thing, first thing is, I mean, just don't follow blindly what somebody has told you. Absolutely, this stop, do not agree for that, do not agree for that. And I have been told by people that I have tried with my parents and they have not listened. I have only told them, watch 3 years again. And plead to them the way Farhan pleaded with their fathers. Your parents will listen.
Okay, so let's plead like that. Stop here. Thanks, Professor Ajit, for this entire... I think that says everything. Thanks a lot. So Ajit will be available for you people to meet till dinner time. He is leaving tomorrow, unfortunately, in the morning. So you can catch him next 2 next 2.